Hello everybody, today we will discuss physiology of cerebellum part 1. In the previous lecture we have learned regarding descending tract and effect of lesion of spinal cord. Now let's start with voluntary control of motor activity. In that we will today learn separately what is cerebellum and its role in regulation of motor activity. So today is part 1. So just to brief out again, role of cerebellum coming in motor activity. If you recall, in the initial I've told you, central nervous system action depends on two inputs. Either there is a information coming from receptor which will go first to the sensory cortex. So it will be basically coming from receptor ascending tract to sensory cortex. So we are giving response to a sensory stimulation, or there is some idea in the mind to do some voluntary activity. For example, I want to write on a blackboard. So this is my idea. So either of this will be a initiation for the motor activity. Now for the execution, impulse will go to the cortical association area, premotor cortex and motor cortex. Now here basically there will be planning and programming of motor activity, but before going down for execution to the spinal cord, it will take opinion from its two of the good siblings called as basal ganglion and cerebellum. So that is why these two areas are called as motor coordination centers. So they will coordinate motor activities and they will influence the actions of motor cortex. On their own, they will not initiate any activity. That's why whenever there is a damage to either basal ganglion and cerebellum, will get disturbed movement. There will be disturbance in the movement. Movement will not be absent. So either you get ataxia or dyskinesia, but person will be able to do a movement. So that's why these are called as motor coordination center. Now after impulse comes back from cerebellum and basal ganglion, this will come down for execution to the spinal cord through the tract called as descending tract. This is the direct, which is from cortex to the spinal cord. And sometimes it is taking a station in between to the brainstem, will be influenced by so many nucleus, vestibular nuclei, reticular formation, and they will come down. So these are called as indirect tracts, which we have learned in detail. All of them will be ultimately ending on spinal cord, either on alpha motor neuron, which is our final common pathway, also called as lower motor neuron, or gamma motor neuron, which is supplying our muscle spindle and maintaining its sensitivity. Third is the interneuron. So cortex will influence the three and they will execute the action. So here basically comes the role of cerebellum, which we'll discuss today, that it is giving feedbacks to motor area for execution of action. So we'll see in detail what are the actions. So based on MCI booklet, the competency number PY 10.7, it is describe and discuss functions of cerebellum. It is along with all other, I've segregated it for cerebellum only. Now motor activity is basically either a reflex or involuntary activity or voluntary activity. So whatever actions coming out from our muscle is either reflexive, that label as involuntary, and many times it is a voluntary. Now the reflexive response is basically, example is rhythmic movements such as swallowing, chewing, scratching and walking, which are largely involuntary. So majority of our actions are basically involuntary actions are there, but on this involuntary action there is a voluntary control. So these are subject to voluntary control and adjustment. So this reflex actions are under voluntary control. Now somatic motor activity, if you recall, is basically depends on pattern and rate of discharge of lower motor neuron. High contraction, low contraction, fast contraction. So ultimately it is a discharge coming from the lower motor neuron, the final common pathway of skeletal muscle, bombardment by impulses from an immense array of descending pathways and other spinal neurons and peripheral afferents. Now this ultimately are coming from descending tract, which are being influenced, as we have seen now, by basal ganglion, cerebellum, and our motor cortex. So this three will influence the action. Now let's start with the cerebellum. So anatomically, location, you can see it is at the brainstem, behind pons and medulla. So this is the location of our cerebellum. It has got three anatomical divisions. This first division is called as the anterior lobe. This is called as a posterior lobe. And this small posterior one, it is called as floccionodular lobe. So this is the side view of cerebellum, located behind the brainstem, behind pons and medulla, having three anatomical divisions in this. Let's have a front look in this one. Again, same division is there, but in addition to this division, further it is divided into hemisphere. So these two lateral structure on either side are called as hemisphere, same as cerebral cortex. There we label them as cerebral hemisphere. So here we are labeling them as cerebellar hemisphere. And in the center, this structure which is looking like a worm is called as a vomis. And this is called as a floccionodular lobe. Now this is again a part of anterior lobe which we have seen from the side view. That means which includes hemisphere, vomis, as well as this intermediate zone. So this is the anterior lobe, this is the posterior lobe, and this is the intermediate zone which is on either side. So this is the front view of our cerebellum. That was the lateral view. So anterior lobe, posterior lobe, floccionodular lobe, and this division is based on hemisphere and vomis. So this is the lateral zone. Now, important for us, as we are discussing physiology, what is a physiological division? So it is based on function and connection of cerebellum with a different part of the brain. So this first area is called as a spinocerebellum. This one, that is, this structure is called as spinocerebellum. As the name indicates, it will have communication with the cerebellum. All connections will be with the cerebellum, either afferents or efferents. This area, which is called as a hemisphere, is called as cerebrocerebellum. As the name indicates, having connection with cerebrum, that is cerebral cortex. And this last one, which is small one, is called as a vestibular cerebellum, which anatomically we are labeling as floccionodular lobe. So these are the three functional divisions of cerebellum: spinocerebellum, cerebrocerebellum, and vestibular cerebellum. Now let's see what are their connections. This first spinocerebellum, it will from the center, that from this vomis area, it is giving to medial descending system. Why you are stressing medial? Because medial tracts are basically controlling body's axial skeleton. They are controlling body's postural muscles, and typically these are controlling bilaterally. For example, our anterior corticospinal tract, which is carrying 15 to 20% fibers and supplying bilaterally to the proximal group of muscles, plus our reticulospinal tract, vestibulospinal tract, these are going medially. So this vomis is having connection with the this descending path which is supplying medially, and this intermediate fibers are supplying to the lateral descending system. Laterals, we have seen lateral corticospinal tract is there, or rubrospinal tract is there, that are they are supplying the distal group of muscle and maintaining the body's movement. So that is the spinocerebellum. So its role is again in motor execution by influencing the spinal cord. Now this cerebrocerebellum is having two motor and premotor cortex. We have seen in the initial diagram of a sketch of motor activities, the cerebral cortex is giving and collecting back information from the cerebellum. So cerebral cortex receives back from the cerebrocerebellum. This is for motor planning. And this third, as the name itself indicates, it will have communication with the vestibular nuclei. So it will be involved in the equilibrium and balance and eye movements. So these are the three functional divisions of cerebellum: spinocerebellum, cerebrocerebellum, and vestibular cerebellum. So ultimately they are having role in the motor execution of motor activities. So the cerebellum influences the rate, range, force, and direction of movement. It is giving feedbacks to cerebral cortex, which will influence back from the cortex to the spinal cord. Now here, this is very, very important. Just like we have seen in case of our cerebral cortex, we were having our homunculus, sensory as well as a motor. Similarly, in the cerebellum also, we are having this homunculus, motor homunculus, but not as fine as in case of cerebral cortex. So it is crude structure, but you can see it is duplication is there. So you can see central part is in the axial, that is vermis, and these are the lateral, which are in the lateral zone. So like this, there is a division. So, and they are controlling the body movements in that fashion only. Now again, everything, as we mentioned, is coming back down on the spinal cord. So whatever we say, whether cerebellum is influencing rate, rhythm, force of contraction, it is ultimately coming down on our either alpha or gamma motor neuron and influencing there. So this is our gamma motor neuron, which is supplying muscle spindle. This is our alpha motor neuron. This is descending tract. Some of them are ending on gamma motor neuron. So you can see their influence is indirect through muscle spindle, but ultimately again from alpha motor neuron. Some tracts are ending on alpha motor neuron and influencing directly the muscle contraction, the spinal cord pathway. So cerebellum is acting or helping in motor movements, ultimately again coming from this our alpha motor neuron only. That's why if this neuron is damaged, we are going to have a hypotonia and loss of reflexes. Even if cerebellum basal ganglion is totally normal but or abnormal, influence is going through this only. So if they are damaged, we will have a loss of movement or loss of reflexes. Now important information the cerebellum collects is basically this, that is a proprioception, that is body position. Now for this we are having three types of receptors. Receptor located in the muscle, these are called as muscle spindle. From here sensory nerve is arising and going to the spinal cord. Now receptor located in the tendon, if you recall, it is called as the Golgi tendon organ. In the inverse stretch reflex phenomena, we have seen its role. It is having a negative, it will lead to muscle relaxation. Third one located in the joints, so these are the free nerve endings at the joints. So all these three receptors located in the muscle, tendon and joint, these are called as proprioceptors. Proprio means body position, septars means receptors. So their main function is proprioception, that is they will give body position. For example, if person is bending forward, impulse will come from all joints and muscles of the body and they will tell the cerebellum that this person is bending forward, that is inflection. If person is bending laterally, so ultimately each and every muscle of the body and the joint and tendon will give these impulses from here to the spinal cord, which will go from the our dorsal spinocerebellar tract, and they will tell what is the body position now. Because whenever you want to do any action, our basic body position is very, very important. For example, if I want to write with my wrist or fingers on the blackboard, only if my finger movements are there, but for the finger movement, there should be proper contraction at the wrist joint, at the elbow joint, at the shoulder joint. Then only I will be able to write on the paper. So my brain should know what is position of my shoulder joint, elbow joint and wrist joint when I want to do a movement. So that is the role of proprioception. They will tell the body position. Now let's move further, and from this sketch we'll try to give roughly what is the role of cerebellum in motor activity. This is our motor cortex. As I mentioned in the earlier, either a sensory impulse coming to the sensory cortex or idea comes in the mind, which will ultimately go to the motor cortex. Now from here impulse will go to the cerebellum and basal ganglion. If you just recall the initial sketch, inputs are going to this. Now cerebellum there develops a plan of action. For example, I want to lift my mobile, which we know is weighing hardly 100 grams. So this is my plan of action. Now the muscle will give proprioception to the cerebellum. That will give what is my current position of the body, whether I'm sitting, standing, what is the level of flexion at the my shoulder joint, my elbow joint, my wrist joint. So if you want to lift my mobile, what actions are required? This is the planning coming from cerebellum. What actions are required? And what is my current position? This will be proprioception. How much should be flexion, extension at different joints? So now both of this planning of action and proprioception are matched, and based on that, what is the requirement? This will go back to thalamus. From here it will go to the corrections, motor cortex. From here it will come to the descending tract. Means you can see, so these are the afferents, two afferents coming to the cerebellum. One afferent coming from spinal cord, one afferent coming from motor cortex. So these are the afferents coming to cerebellum. And this is efferent going to cortex. Now this efferent from cerebellum, they are going via thalamus. So now again role of thalamus is coming. So thalamus got important role in motor action also. If you recall, in our own sensory system, all sensory tracts are relaying at thalamus. Similarly, motor action is also going from thalamus. Now here you have seen cerebellum is giving impulse to thalamus. From thalamus it is going to cerebral cortex. Now let's see, motor action, plan of action is coming from cortex, it will go to the cerebellum. Now body position is coming from spinal cord to the cerebellum. Now both will be matched. How much amount of contraction required? I will give example. For example, I want to lift my mobile. For this I need some flexion at my wrist joint and elbow joint, some contraction. Same, I want to lift my laptop. Now this laptop is weighing around 2 kg, while my mobile is weighing around 100 grams. Same action is I want to lift, but just see, the amount of contraction required for my mobile is very less, and amount of contraction required for to lift my laptop is more, 10 times more as compared to my mobile. So action is same sort of flexion at my elbow joint as well as wrist joint. Same action, but degree of contraction required is more or less. So that is the role of basically cerebellum. It will adjust the rate and force of contraction. Action is same. There is a flexion, particular flexion at elbow joint, particular flexion at wrist joint. But amount of contraction tone required is different. For lifting a mobile, suppose the tone required, say it is 10 degrees. For my laptop, it is 200 degrees. Okay, so that is the, so cerebellum will adjust that. That is called as a tuning of motor activities. So now this action will go from cerebellum back to thalamus, from motor cortex coming down to spinal cord. From here now it will go to muscle contraction. So that is the role of cerebellum. It will try to match plan of action with the proprioception and will give necessary corrections whether contraction required is more or less. When I'm moving from my lifting my mobile to laptop, contraction required is more. In reverse, from after lifting a laptop, I want to lift my mobile, requirement will be less, contraction has to be reduced. So that is the role of cerebellum. So this red nucleus, if you recall, it has got the same action as cortical spinal tract, but under normal condition, it is being oppressed by presence of motor cortex, so it is not visible. Action is same as the cortical spinal tract. It becomes visible when there is a damage to motor cortex. So this is the reticulospinal tract and cerebrospinal tract. Now this histologically, if you take a section of the cerebellum, it has got 3 layers are there. First layer, this layer appearing like a molecule, is called as a molecular layer. The second layer, you can see here, this layer in which the neurons are there, which are looking like a Purkinje, biggest cells. This is a Purkinje cell layer. Third one, that is a granular cell layer. So these 3 layers are there. So if you take a section of a cerebellum, we'll have 3 layers visible. So here in this, now different types of neurons are there. So in the next lecture, we'll see what is the detailed structure of a molecular layer, what are the contents of Purkinje cell layer, what are the contents of granular cell layer, and how they are basically ultimately influencing output coming from cerebellum. So up till now, we have seen in this plan of action of motor activity. Then we have seen anatomical structure of a cerebellum. We have seen physiological division of cerebellum. Then how the cerebellum plays role in the motor activity. It is getting a plan of action from cortex, and it is getting the current position coming from our spinal cord, and it will say the necessary corrections via thalamus to the cortex. And here these are the three layers are there: molecular layer, Purkinje cell layer, and granular cell layer. So next time we'll discuss in detail the functions of different neurons. Thank you.